everyone. This is your host, J.R. Michael, with another episode of Make That Bloody Movie with Coffee. And in tonight's episode, I will have a special guest and actor from Blue Bloods. Got a little tongue tied there, Mike Emery. And he will be telling you the coffee of the night towards the end of the episode, as well as I will. And you guys can decide which one you like better, which doesn't really matter, but it's okay. All right. Mike Emery, he's been in Bone, Tomahawk, Bad Parents, and All My Children, and as well, I said before, Blue Bloods. He's a hell of an actor. He's fantastic. He's dynamic on screen and off screen, and he has a heart of gold, and he's very humble and sincere, and he's a really good guy, and I'm very honored to have him on my show. And here you go, Mike. Take it away. Give the audience a little bit. Tell them about yourself, and have fun.
Hey guys, how you doing? No, thank you again, JR and Jolie, for having me on the show. It's quite an honor. I've been in the business now for about 12 years, and acting's been my life and passion, day in, day out, and it's just something I love to do. It's not a job to me. It's cool. It's more like, I don't know. It's more of like my life, and I don't consider acting a job. I just consider it fun, and I feel like jobs are boring and they're work, and it's not cool. But yeah, once I'm on set, I mean, it's playtime. Like I'm a kid, you know. Like, and it's crazy because I get paid to be a kid. I get paid for make believe, which is incredible. So I mean, it's a win-win for me. It's been a whirlwind. You know, there's a lot of ups and downs with the business, peaks and valleys, but those peaks are what make me run. It's like the gasoline in my car, you know, it keeps me pushing forward, and it's something I love, and I could never see myself doing anything else, you know?
Well, can you tell everybody out there, like, what made you get into this field, especially when you have, you know, parents and family members always say, like, why you want to do that? You know, it's...
Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah. So get this. My dad is an old school Italian guy, right? So he's like a 9-to-5, you know, you get married when you're 30, you have a kid when you're 31, all that good stuff. Right. So,
right.
And my mom's a teacher, and my sister is a nurse, and I have the most amazing parents and sister in the world. They're so supportive and they're incredible. But you know, when I first got into acting, my dad was like, what are you doing? Like, you're not going to make any money. You're just going to be, you know, auditioning in a dark room by yourself. And it's just, you know, I mean, it's hard. But then I got some success, and he saw how driven and passionate I was about this business. And it just bled over into their feelings. And, you know, they've been supportive since day one. But it's just a hard transition to see your son or daughter, you know, starting off and just, you know, in a field where it's just like a one percentile make it. So. So, you know, what got me into acting was I played college football at Monmouth University, and once I stopped playing football, I saw Monmouth University has a good drama school. They have a good drama section in their curriculum. So I saw some flyers, right, for a play that they were doing, if they're having auditions for some play, and I was like, that's all right. I'm not gonna, you know, I'm gonna get made fun of. I play football. I'm this, you know, big guy, and I don't want to, like, you know, show my emotions and, you know, all that good stuff. So I got and I auditioned, and it was just natural for me. And I was like, wow, this is really cool. This is fun. Like, the teacher was like, yeah, I mean, have you ever done this before? And I was like, no. And he's like, all right, memorize this monologue. So I came back the next week and I memorized this monologue from the play that they were in production for, and it was just opened up so many doors of emotional stuff when I was a kid, and just broke me down from A to Z, and I just fell in love. I got bit by the bug, man. When I was 19, I got bit by the bug, and then I started taking acting classes, right? Over in Red Bank, New Jersey, I started taking some acting classes. And after those, I auditioned for the American Academy of Dramatic Arts over in Manhattan, which is a really prestigious drama school. So they make you audition twice. So you go in, they give you some sides to read, right? Prepare them and go in and read for the whole curriculum, the whole all the teachers and the the head production people, producers of the school. So there's like 8 people on this table staring at you. And it's really scary, especially if you're not experienced. And I wasn't experienced. You know, I was like 20 years old. I was like, oh, my God, like, what do I do? So I went in and I did the audition, and they liked it. And they called me back in for the next week. So I took the train from Bayhead, New Jersey. Uh-huh. I took the train and I took the train into the city, and I came back and I auditioned again. It was more of like a cold read. They gave me a play, and I read that, and it was funny. I was reading with another female actress who was already in the school. She was a second year, so it's a 2-year school. So the second years are like the seniors of the high school, and the first year is a freshman, basically. So we did the scene together, and then I started to cry in the scene, and I was like, whoa, where did that come from? And it just hit a chord with me, and it was so organic. And it was a great, I'll never forget the audition. It was great, and it got me into the school, and it was the most intense training I've ever had for 2 years. And I still, to this day, have the same acting coach, Jackie Bartone. She's amazing. I still have her since I'm 36, and I was 20 when I met her, and we're still working together for 16 years. And she's taught me everything about acting, about life, about being a young man, being an adult, being mature, kind of, I tried to be, doing the right thing. And
right.
So that's kind of how I got jump-started, pretty much.
Oh, awesome. I mean, that's an interesting journey you went through. I want to, so now, Mike, since you pretty much gave us that, biography about yourself, which is very fascinating. And I love to hear the story every time you tell me about it.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to get to the questions because, you know, these questions everybody wanted me to ask you. The first question is, do you think an actor has to go to college and get a theater degree in order to make it just like a normal job? Or
No. Some of the best actors I know are from the streets. Like, it's called life experience for me personally. The more life experience you have as a person, I think the better actor you're going to be, because you can pull from all different sources of your life, whether it's hardships you've had, whether if you're broke, whether if you get divorced, whether you get kicked out of school, if you have a tough childhood with your parents, or whatever it is, you know?
That's amazing.
I don't feel like you need, I mean, it's always good to have a coach, I feel like. Right. I like the one-on-one setting with my private coach, but I know some of the best actors I've worked with, they never took an acting class. Hey, take this, for example, Heath Ledger.
Yeah.
Never took an acting class in his life. Never.
Really?
Never, 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 never.
Oh, wow.
He said, I learn everything when I'm on set. So, I mean, I don't know. I feel like you don't need it, because I feel like the more organic and the less trained, you know, you are in certain aspects, the more natural you're going to be, the more subtleties, the more real the actor or actress, the more, you know, the artist is going to be. So if you're, you know, gun to my head, I don't really feel like you need to be, you know, to have a degree or to go to a 5-year college for acting. I just feel like life experience and who you are as an artist.
It's interesting. You know,
it's for sure. So that's how I feel about it.
No, that's amazing. It's interesting you say that, because another actor who did say that was Mark Wahlberg. He said...
another guy. Yeah, street man. It's life experience right there, you know? A tough, gritty life, you know?
Yeah. And it's interesting because, you know, getting into this field, and if you're new at this, everybody, and you're trying to make it, or you're trying to get somewhere with your career, you know, Mike was saying is, you just, you know... If you have trouble or arguments with your parents or whatever you're facing in life, you can take that energy and just put it out into your acting. And sometimes it's better than, no offense, you know, training and stuff like that. And I agree with you, Mike. You feel the emotion, you know, just like when you cried in that, you know, scene, and you didn't know where it was coming from.
I had no idea. It just snuck up on me, and it was beautiful because it wasn't planned. It wasn't, all right, after this line, I'm going to cry. It was just, it just popped and happened. And, you know, it reads well. It reads well for the audience, and it reads well, more importantly, for yourself, you know?
No, that's amazing. That's awesome. Yeah. All right, let's go into question number two. Do you think talent is all you need, or is connection more important for an actor?
That's a good question. Yeah, talent's important, but for me personally, like, the more connections you have, the more work you're going to get, and the better you're going to get as an artist. So, I mean, if you know a lot of people, look, I mean, this is the business, right? I mean, yeah. It's who you know, right? That they always say that. I mean, that's true. I mean, it's, if you know someone high up, they can get you and stuff. But look, I mean, talent can only take you so far. You have to have other intangibles to be an artist. You have to be able to communicate. You have to be able to have that hard work and that grit and that bite to you. You have to have perseverance. You know, you're going to get your butt. Can I curse on here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. You're going to get your ass kicked a lot out here. You know, this is the life of an artist. You're going to get your ass kicked, because you're going to get 100 no's. But that one yes, man, I tell you, that one yes, you got to take full advantage of that one yes. You got to run with it to the end zone, because, you know, you can't squander any opportunities in this business, because, you know, I've known a lot of people that, you know, had the world by the balls, and then they just screwed up that one opportunity, and that could have propelled them to the next level. So
that's an interesting way to look at it. It's almost like when I hear you say that, I think of an archaeologist finding the famous treasure that you never know where that treasure is going to be, but then you keep looking, and then all of a sudden, like Indiana Jones, you found it, and you're like, yeah.
Right. Exactly, right. You're hunting all day for that one fossil, that one bone that can get you millions, or can get you, you know, to get that treasure. And then, you know, you don't give up. You find it, man. You got to keep going. You got to keep digging. You know, that's what I'm saying. You can't give up.
Awesome, Mike. Awesome. All right. Yeah. Question number three. Do you think an actor knowing things behind the scene makes an actor more valuable, and being a well-rounded actor to make it in this business?
100%. So I was thinking about this question, and how I interpret this is, if I know where a camera is positioned during a scene, like if I'm experienced behind the scenes, so if I've directed something before, if I've written something before, if I've produced something before, if I was a friggin' PA, you know,
right?
I know how cameras work, and I watch whenever I'm on set, I always watch. I watch the director, how they act and how they talk. I watch everybody, because that's my job. I want to know what's going on, you know? But when I'm on set, I can see where the camera's positioned, so I can, you know, modify my body in the scene to look a certain way, or to add emphasis on some of the dialogue that I'm doing. So it's always important to know where you are as an actor, and then behind the scenes too, is to know what's going on. Like, where's the camera position? What notes is the director giving you? You have to always pay attention, always be on your feet. Everything's being rewritten, you know? You can have rewrites that morning of the shoot. I've had times where I was on set and I had like a 10-page scene, and 9 of the pages were rewritten, and I had to memorize it within the 2 hours before I went on. So you always gotta be on your feet. You always gotta know what's going on behind the scenes, because that's just gonna add more levels and more dimensions to your performance.
Wow, that was intense.
yeah.
Amazing. You know, a lot of actors coming into this business, when you said you have to know where the camera's positioned in order to angle yourself, to be honest with you, I never heard that before, and that's something that I think it's amazing. Thank you for sharing that with everybody, because, you know, most people, they'll say, oh, you know, I'll get on set and I'll do my part, but they're not really focused on where the camera's position as an actor, not saying as a cinematographer, but as an actor.
Yeah, where I learned that the most was working on the soap operas, because they use a three camera shot. They use the three camera shot on soap operas. So literally there's three cameras filming the one scene, because they do, you know, they do 8 episodes a week.
Right.
It's constant. They fly by. So you have to be on your mark every time every time the camera moves, for camera one, camera two, camera three. You have to be in perfect position. It's like choreography. It's like a dance almost. Like,
wow.
You have to step with your left. Camera one takes you. Camera two on this line. When you hit this line, you got to be on camera two. So working on soap operas actually kind of like, it was probably the hardest and most challenging work I've done on TV because, first of all, the memorization, you get 10 pages or 12 pages or 13 pages every night to learn for the next day. And then two, you can't fuck up because they're shooting so many pages a day that, you know, if you mess up, you're just eating their time away to shoot the rest of the episode. So everything's, time is money, you know, especially with TV, time is money.
Right.
So you got to be on, you got to know where you're going. You have to know where the blocking is. You have to know, you know, where your scene's going to be. You have to know where your partner is going to be. So, yeah.
That is, wow. It's almost like when I hear you talk about TV, soap opera, it's almost like theater. Because theater is kind of similar.
Exactly. It's the same thing. Yeah, it's the same thing.
Wow.
Except you're not projecting. You're just talking normally. But yeah, it's the same kind of thing. You can't mess up. You get one shot. That's it.
Wow. That's interesting. Yeah. Question number four. Do you think having a publicist, it's very important to an actor in order for them to be noticed to succeed?
Not at first. When you're starting out, when you're starting out, always go find a good manager. That's it. So a manager's job is to guide the actor's career. If the actor has a question about headshots, about the reel, about an audition, about what to wear to an audition, about a side job to help supplement their income to be an actor, always go for a manager first, not an agent. Always go for a manager when you're starting out, the first couple of years when you're an actor. Then when you start to do work, then when you're, you know, 5, 6, 7 years down the road, then you can get a publicist so they can start promoting your career, so they can reach out on social media, on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, you know, LinkedIn, so they can kind of promote you and push you. But once you have credits under your belt, like sustainable ones and substantial ones, then I go for a publicist. But for now, if you're starting out, just find a good manager. Find a good manager who you love and who you talk to and who's honest with you. And if you suck, they got to tell you suck. If you're great, they got to tell you you're great. You know, if you're down, they got to bring you up. So that's someone that it's hard to find, but definitely a manager. I have a great manager. I have a great agent, but it took a long time to find those people in my corner. I've been through hundreds of managers and agents, but, you know, you've got to find the right one who believe in you as an artist and, more importantly, a person too. So if they don't believe you as a person, why the hell are they going to want to work with you anyway?
That is so true. And, yeah. And you know, it's interesting because when you're saying this, I'm thinking of it's like a puzzle, how you're putting it together. And I think outside of the acting world, you know, regular people have a hard time understanding what we as actors and writers and producers, we go through, because it's actually through the years, you're putting all these pieces together in order for it to kind of click.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, look, to be honest with you, there's no set path to an acting career. There's no set path. There's only the path that you create. You know, it's everyone's path is different. You know, I think Samuel L. Jackson didn't get his first break till he was 50.
Yeah.
You know, it's everyone's different, you know, like
Morgan Freeman was an electrician.
Yeah. Harrison Ford was a carpenter when he got the call for Star Wars. So it's like, you know, it's weird, man. It's weird, you know. So my friend Scout Taylor Compton, who is an incredible actress, she's on Halloween 1 and 2, Rob Zombie's Halloween 1 and 2, and she's one of the best actresses I know, and her and I've done 5 films together. She started acting when she was 9.
Oh, wow.
So, like, so everyone's different, you know. I didn't start till I was 20, so I'm 36 now. So it's like, you know, everyone has a different path, different careers, but, you know, as long as you stick with it and you love it, it doesn't really matter, you know. It doesn't matter when you get your break. As long as you're passionate about it, then who cares? You know, you're doing what you love to do.
You're right. That's so true. I think a lot of people, you know what it is, Mike? A lot of people at a certain point, when they don't see like the seeds they plant blossom, they get discouraged and then they kind of stop and say, let me go to a regular job. But I remember one of my friends was telling me he was on Batman, the set with Christian Bale. And the guy who played the cop from, and I think he acted on the TV show Third Rock. I don't know. You might know that actor.
Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Yeah, Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Yeah, he was saying that he kept doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it, just like you. And he started to see doors open, and he said that a lot of people, they just give up after 5 or 6 years. And he says the ones who last, like you said, the 10, 15, 20 years, something cracks and opens up, you know?
It's a marathon, JR. It's a marathon. This is if you pick this life to live, you have to know that. I mean, at first, I got discouraged a lot at first, you know, because I didn't get into the SAG union until 2007, and I started acting. It took me 7 years to get my SAG card. So it took a long time, but then once you got that, you know, you get into the union, you know, you feel good about yourself as an artist, you get the ball rolling, you know, things become more real, things become more visceral, things become more intense. It's great. But yeah, when you're starting out, you know, the biggest thing is just, you know, and I have to remind myself now too, like, keep your head up and always just keep pushing forward, knowing that you're doing good work, you're constantly training, you're constantly bettering yourself as an artist and working on your craft and making yourself stronger. And I'm always reading books too. I'm always reading like Meisner books, Stanislavski books. I'm always reading those. I'll go to Barnes & Noble and just sit there for hours and just read like a bunch of different acting books and different biographies on, like Heath Ledger's biography is one of my favorite books. I read that, and I've read books on Al Pacino, just stuff how they view life, how they view acting, and how they view, you know, human behavior, which is what acting is. It's the study of human behavior. So, you know, I would go, when I was in New York, I just ride in the subway, and I'd get a newspaper. This may sound creepy, but whatever.
Go ahead.
I would get a newspaper, and I would just people watch. I would see how people on the subway. I would just take the subway for like a couple hours, and just, that was my acting class. I would just watch people and how they behaved, how they interacted with one another. If someone would make room for someone else to sit down, if a woman and a child were standing, would the man move over? I would make bets in my head. I bet you he doesn't move, but he did a lot of the time. So it's, ooh, you know, it's just people I'd interact with each other. So it's very, interesting to people watch and just study the human behavior in certain situations. And
that's kind of funny. I mean, hey, everyone, if you're ever on the number 7 train, be careful with the newspaper.
Yeah, you got to watch out.
Michael Emery, he'll be watching you.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
not... I'll have the gray hat on. So,
yeah. You know, that would be a good skit to do, actually, if you did it, where you're sitting on the train and then you kind of say, how to become an actor in 2020, just sit on the train and have a newspaper.
Watch the people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right, just get the New York Post and you're good.
Yeah, right, right.
That's your cover.
Yeah. Exactly. I had another question. Well, not really a question. Do you have anything else you want to tell everybody out there as an upcoming artist or actor? What is it that they need to look out for?
Yeah, I'm really excited. I just finished an independent film with Keir Gilchrist and from Atypical and the Netflix series. He was a lead. And I finished, you know, and Scout Taylor Compton, who we all know, she's also in the movie. It's called An Intrusion. Nicholas Holland directed the film and Sam Logan produced it. It's the most incredible thriller I've ever worked on. It's probably one of the best scripts I've ever read. We shot that in Detroit, Michigan last month in December. So that was the last project I did of 2019. And it's going to be coming out mid 2020. So yeah, keep your eyes open for An Intrusion. It's an incredible movie, and I'm so excited for people to see it.
Well, congratulations, Mike Emery, everyone. And of course, we're now reaching the end of the hour, and I just want him to let you guys know what was his coffee of the evening.
All right, surprise, surprise. So I got 7-Eleven blueberry flavored coffee. There you go.
Ooh, okay. Coffee and blueberry. I never had that before. I definitely got to try that from 7-Eleven.
Yeah, you're missing out, Jerry. You got to try it.
All right. Thanks. And the coffee of the night that I'm having, ladies and gentlemen, next to Mike Emery, is hazelnut coffee from Dunkin' Donuts. Light and sweet.
Little D&D, man. It's awesome. That's good stuff. I like that.
Thanks. Well, again, everyone, thank you for joining us with Make That Bloody Movie with Coffee. And our episode today was with Mike Emery and his acting journey. And what a wonderful And I appreciate it again. Thank you so much for coming on the show and telling everybody, you know, what it takes to become an actor in this day and age. And, you know, we really appreciate that. And we wish you all the best, Mike, and all the prayers. And I want to see more. What can I say?
JR and Julie, thank you so much. It's been an honor and pleasure. And, I could talk for hours, obviously. But, I love you guys. Thank you so much for your time. And I hope people enjoy this, man. Thank you so much.
We love you too, Michael Emery. And thank you. You inspired me with a lot of more ideas and stuff. And I have to say that, I'm flattered to have known you and got to meet you through Randy and stuff. And just thank you, man. It's an honor.
Oh, it's my pleasure, man. Thank you so much. Have a great night, guys. Thank you for your time.
You too. Take it easy.
All right, take care.